Okay, good afternoon everyone, and thanks for coming. I thank the organizers for the opportunity. So before I start my talk, I would like to ask you a simple question. So you can see two honeybees here. Can you identify the queen bee? There's a worker bee and a queen bee. So can you identify the queen bee? Which one? Yeah, that's right. So I bet few of you know about why queen bee is queen bee and worker is not, because they started their life as babies in the form of insect larva when they were looking the same, but now they look very different. The reason behind this is not only important for the structural development of bees, but also important for our well-being and human health. So moving on to my topic, which is nature inspired cure to the incurable. So the key word here is cure. So what is cure? If you look at the Merriam-Webster dictionary, cure in essence means care. It came from the Latin word called cura, which means a divine guard that can protect us from the evil things. So in that sense, literally, incurable means the diseases or the factors that cannot be taken care of. So there are so many incurable diseases known in the world, and as if that is not enough, we keep inventing new ones because of our lifestyle. But these two diseases you can see, which is cancer and diabetes, have been known since BC. Are we not caring to cure them? We do, right? We spend a lot of money, the government spend a lot of money, but still, it's incurable. Why? When we have a problem, we have to get into the root of the problem, and what we do right now is treatment. That is the surface, the output we are treating, but the actual underlying cause we are not treating. So now we have traveled a long way since BC, and we now know the information which we don't know long ago, and that is the genome. So let me introduce to the human genome. So this is us. So we are made from letters, 3 billion of them, A, T, G, C. And the genome of human is so identical that we can call it as one universal genome. And where are these letters in our body? These letters are stacked up in a double helical structure, which we all know, DNA or deoxyribonucleic acid, and the functional unit of the DNA is called gene, and that has been transcribed or passed on to the biological system through a code called genetic code, which you see on the right. So there are about 30,000 genes known. And modern technologies helps us to identify some of the genes which are very sensitive. Like when there is a problem in those genes, then disease can occur. But it also helps us to identify some of the genes which can take care of those problems. These genes are called guard genes or caretaker genes. Let me introduce to the most important caretaker, which is popularly known as guardian of the genome. That is P53. Imagine this is our cell, the cute little smiley, being our cell, very happy. And when disease signal happen, what this P53 does is that it starts a machinery to either repair them, or if it's irreparable, arrest them. If there's no hope, then cause cell death. So what happens when P53 is not present or being blocked, like by the gene called E6, the oncogene shown here? That results in cancer, which is the uncontrolled cell division. In fact, 50% of the cancer is known to have P53 affected. So how can we restore this gene? People have developed many strategies, and one of the strategies got inspired from the nature, from the tiny, tiny living organism called bacteria. Why bacteria? So bacteria, if you see the microenvironment, it lives in a very, very complex environment filled with infectious agents like virus, you can see in the black here. So they are ready, or they want to infect the bacteria by injecting the DNA into that. How bacteria protects itself? What it have is an immune system called CRISPR-Cas9. So CRISPR is a system that can specifically recognize the foreign DNA elements. And Cas9 is a DNA repair protein that is shown in the scissor. So what happens is that it can specifically target and edit the viral DNA element to take away the virus infection. So people started using this technology for their purpose, and there have been many CRISPR systems developed. So one of the CRISPR-Cas9 system called E6 CRISPR-Cas9 was developed by the researchers in North Carolina. What they did is that I told you that this oncogene called E6 could arrest or block P53. So what they did is that they tried and developed a system to cut the blocking agent to restore the National Guard. This is good. And this is not only applicable for the P53 restoration, but many disease-causing genes or disease-associated genes could be edited now. For example, HIV, muscular dystrophy, and so on. But there is a problem, is that not many people like their gene to be modified when they have a disease, right? And there's also another layer that can control the gene expression. That is called epigenetics. So what is epigenetics? So epigenetics is a process that lies above the genome to switch off or on the gene. Off means silenced and on means expressed. Now I said a word called expression. So you might have heard this expression called gene expression. What is that? So we all know DNA in the form of double helical structure as shown here. But it's very long, about 20 meter long. So how they are located inside our cell? It's because they get wound around the natural protein called histones, shown in yellow here, like shown here. And in this way, they wind around the histones to be packaged. So this position of histones determine whether the gene is silenced or expressed. For example, if this is the gene coding DNA, then what happens is that this is how a silenced gene looks like. So what determines the position of histones is the tiny marks around or over the genome called silence marks, shown as the red button there. So can you read what's in there? So this is off gene because we can't read it. And what is on gene? Can you read them now? So this is gene on. So there are some marks shown in green here which can cause expression by unwinding the DNA from the histone protein. So these marks are called expression marks. So previously I asked you a question. Why worker bee looks like worker bee and queen bee looks like queen bee? Now is the time for answer. So as I told, it started their life as bee larva, but it became as worker or queen. Why? Because there's a strange rule in the bee world that after some time, some set of larvae are fed with worker jelly, and other set of larvae are fed with royal jelly. So you can see the royal jelly below the yellow protein. So what is the secret ingredient in royal jelly? It's the small molecule called fatty acid. So this small molecule acts as a switch to silence the silencing mark, which is shown in the red. So when this happens, the gene gets expressed and queen factors get released to make the queen bee. So that's the answer. That's the story of queen bee. But that doesn't stop there. We, humans, also have the same situation. Several disease-causing epi signals like environmental toxicants and stress and smoking or drinking, all of them are very bad to our body, and it leaves a mark on not only us but also our child and even grandchild. So for some of you who already corrupted the system enough and are afraid to be blamed by the child or grandchild, please don't worry. Tell them that it is reversible. Don't worry. So there is a way to reverse the bad epigenetic mark. How can we do that? Again, there are several ways to do that. But one method that both clinicians and patients prefer is to use simple small molecule. So this small molecule acts as switches, as I told, to remove the silencing epigenetic mark. Imagine this is the genome of our disease cell. And small molecule switches can enter the genome and affect the silenced gene. As you can see, the natural guard, which is P53, got restored. But there are also other genes which are not supposed to be disturbed, like the normal genes or functional genes. Those are also got activated. So the issue is selectivity. So this is the key area where scientists want to develop a way to target their epigenetic switches to specific places. So how can we do that? Talking about specificity, I'll introduce you to the sequence-specific DNA binder, a small molecule called pyrrole imidazole polyamides, or PIPs. So this PIP was discovered by Professor Peter Derwin of Caltech, and from the natural antibiotic distamycin from Streptomyces bacteria and the amino acid histidine. So pyrrole is shown as the blue circle and imidazole is shown as the red circle. So the position of pyrrole and imidazole can read specific sequences or letters. For example, pyrrole-pyrrole placement can read either A or T, and imidazole-pyrrole can read either G or C, and so on. And good thing is that this small molecule can enter our cell and bind to the DNA. So what we did in our laboratory headed by Professor Sugiyama is that we combined the selective DNA binder, which I showed you now, which is PIP, with the epigenetic activating small molecule, in this case, a small molecule called SAHA, shown as a star there. So we combine the both to make a nature-inspired genetic switch called SAHA-PIP. So in nature, gene expression is controlled in both genetic level and epigenetic level. So now we have a small molecule which can access both the genetic environment and the epigenetic environment. So what this small molecule can do? So we made several SAHA-PIPs. I don't have time to discuss them all, but I'll say some of the three major SAHA-PIPs we discovered to have bioactivity. So you can see that the red circle is positioned at various places. So these SAHA-PIPs are expected to bind to different DNA sequences. So we tested the bioactivity of SAHA-PIP in human skin cell. And one SAHA-PIP actually activated the stem cell related gene called OCT4. This is a key gene that is important for stem cell development. Another SAHA-PIP did not activate OCT4, but activated an entirely different set of genes, particularly a key gene called PV, whose absence can cause infertility. And other SAHA-PIP activated a gene called PAX6, which is very important for eye development. As you can see, these genetic switches are much, much more selective than the normal small molecule switches. So we also activated some of the guard genes. For example, a HIV-1 silencing gene called MX2 got activated by one different SAHA-PIP. And the autism, you know the disease autism, it's very, these days it's very popular among the children, like because of the bad environment, many people now have autism, and the gene called CNTNAP2, which can suppress autism, also got activated. And the gene that can suppress obesity also got activated, which is MX2. Let me caution you that at this moment, we are using the SAHA-PIP as a research-only tool. But our ultimate aim is to use them for the clinical application. For that, we have to do many consideration for the design of SAHA-PIP, because epigenome is very complex and it's not so simple as I have described in the form of green or red button. But I'm confident that at some point we can develop this small molecule to be used for the clinical application. To conclude, I would like to emphasize that we started to know what causes the disease by discovering the DNA double helical structure in 1950. And 2001, we made a very, very important achievement, which is the completion of Human Genome Project. And after that, we have been making discoveries so fast that discovery has become like a daily news. And I'm sure that with the nature-inspired technology like CRISPR-Cas9 and DNA-based epigenetic switch and others, cure can come anytime soon. Because I strongly believe in this saying that nothing cures like nature. Thank you.